on the bottom.
Put it on the bottom?
Yeah.
Okay. Now do everything that you're going to do.
Okay. There we go.
Yeah, the first one right now.
Yeah. So as you see, we're, you know, our series, we call it Unspoken. And the person we're going to talk about today is Hagar. And Hagar is one of those women of the Bible that we rarely talk about. We rarely hear lessons about her, but her story has impacted my life for many years. She's one of those Bible characters that's spoken to my heart. And in preparing for this lesson, I did this lesson, one a lesson like this a while back. And then in preparing more for this one, there's a woman I listened to. Her name is Shadia Hritchie. And I think that's how she says her last. I'm not sure. But she has a thing she teaches on Hagar. So I learned some more stuff from that. But hopefully you'll get a lot from it today. And hopefully you'll walk away with something new, something that helps your heart, draw you closer to God, moves you in some way. Now, as we're about to go in Genesis 16, and something to know as well, I'm going to have all the scriptures on the screen. And so you'll see it. And so you can just follow along there. At the time we first meet Hagar, Abraham and Sarah, it's before their names were changed. And so they're referred to as Abram and Sarai. But for the purpose of just doing this lesson, I'll call them Sarah and Abraham, even though the words may say differently. Now our story begins approximately 11 years after God promised Abraham he would be the father of many nations. So approximately 11 years after is where our story begins. And we're going to pick it up in Genesis chapter 16. It says in Genesis 16 verse 1, now Sarah, Abram's wife, had not been able to bear children for him, but she had an Egyptian servant named Hagar. So Sarah said to Abraham, "The Lord has prevented me from having children. Go and sleep with my servant. Perhaps I can have children through her." And Abraham agreed with Sarah's proposal. So Sarah, Abram's wife, took Hagar, the Egyptian servant, and gave her to Abraham as a wife. This happened 10 years after Abraham had settled in the land of Canaan. So Abram had sexual relations with Hagar, and she became pregnant. But when Hagar knew she was pregnant, she began to treat her mistress, Sarah, with contempt. Then Sarah said to Abraham, "This is all your fault," which is kind of crazy. She told him to do it. But anyhow, "This is all your fault. I put my servant into your arms, but now that she's pregnant, she treats me with contempt. The Lord will show who's wrong, you or me." Abraham replied, "Look, she's your servant, so deal with her as you see fit." Then Sarah treated Hagar so harshly that she finally ran away. The angel of the Lord found Hagar beside a spring of water in the wilderness along the road to Shur. The angel said to her, "Hagar, slave of Sarah, where have you come from and where are you going?" "I'm running away from my mistress, Sarah," she replied. The angel of the Lord said to her, "Return to your mistress and submit to her authority." Then he added, "I will give you more descendants than you can count." And the angel also said, "You are now pregnant and will give birth to a son. You are to name him Ishmael," which means "God hears. For the Lord has heard your cry of distress. The son of yours will be a wild man, as untamed as a wild donkey. He will raise his fist against everyone, and everyone will be against him. Yes, he will live in open hostility against all his relatives." She gave this name to the Lord who spoke to her, "You are the God who sees me," for she said, "I have now seen the one who sees me." That is why the well was called Beer Lahai-Roi. It is still there between Kadesh and Bered. So Hagar bore Abram a son, and Abraham gave the name Ishmael to the son she had born. Abram was 86 years old when Hagar bore him Ishmael. So now let's unpack this story together. So we see Hagar here. She's a stranger in a foreign land, and she's a personal property of Sarah. To do as Sarah would see fit, even the child that she would bear would be the property of her mistress. Now, Hagar had every reason to feel unimportant, to feel insignificant, and to feel used. Now, Hagar is believed to have been acquired by Abraham when he and Sarah were in Egypt, and that time they lied about Sarah being Abraham's sister. Genesis 12:16 tells us that Pharaoh gave Abraham men servants and maid servants. So we believe this is where they got Hagar. Now, God had promised Sarah that she would have a child, but as Sarah is getting older, she panics. She gets desperate, and she decides to take things into her own hands. When we choose to take things into our own hands instead of trusting God and trusting his plans, someone is bound to get hurt. Now, Sarah's suggestion to give her slave to Abraham was an acceptable custom at the time. Now, when things unfolded, Sarah is angry with how things have turned out. She gets upset with Abraham and began mistreating Hagar, all because of a plan Sarah came up with. But nevertheless, she got angry and upset. She made life so difficult for Hagar that Hagar did the only thing she could think of at the time, which was to flee. And if you think about it, that's a pretty desperate move for a pregnant woman, to run away. Hagar felt used, abused, alone, and did the only thing she felt empowered at the time to do, which was to run. She runs, but she can't outrun God. And we're told in verse 7 that the angel of the Lord found Hagar. And the Hebrew definition here for found is an active pursuing. You know, Hagar felt alone and unloved, but God was with her. God went in pursuit of a runaway slave. He never lost sight of her. And that's pretty special to think of, that God went pursuing a runaway slave. And the angel tells her to go back and submit to Sarah. And at this point, you'd be like, what? Go back and submit to Sarah? But yeah, that's what the angel tells her to do. And this is a hard pill to swallow. And at times, God calls us to do things that doesn't make sense. And frankly, at times, doesn't seem fair. Now, what Sarah did was wrong. But as a servant, Hagar didn't have the right to flee. And the truth is, running away is rarely the answer. But God took the time to not only tell her to go back, he also gave her a promise. And it's a promise like no other woman the Bible has received. And she got the same promise like Abram. It's a parallel promise to what was given to Abraham. The Lord blesses her with the highest possible honor for a woman at that time. He tells her, I will increase your descendants so much that they'll be too numerous to count. And I say the honor for a woman of that time. I'm not sure I personally would consider it a blessing right now, but for a woman at that time that her descendants would be increased like that, that was an amazing honor. And I guess it still is an honor. The angel also tells her what to name the baby. It says, you're to name him Ishmael, which means God hears, for the Lord has listened to your affliction. Ishmael's name would be a permanent reminder to Hagar that the Lord hears and that the Lord listens. And I think that's important for us to hear, that God hears and that he listens. God takes notice when we suffer. He has not abandoned us or forsaken us when we're suffering. At times in the midst of our suffering, it's easy to feel that way. That God, where are you? But it tells us here that God hears and God listens. And I like the way that Psalm 56 verse 8 describes it. It says, you keep track of all my sorrows. You have collected all my tears in your bottle. And what a special imagery that is, that God's kept all our tears in a bottle and he keeps track of all our sorrow. And not only does he see our tears, he also goes through the pain with us. He takes notice of the tears. He takes notice of when we cry. There's a translation of this scripture that says, tears are prayers too. They travel to God when we can't speak. I believe we've all had times when the pain is so deep are the disappointments so great that all we can do is cry? And all those tears that we cry have traveled to God as prayers. He heals our pain. He also tells us in Isaiah 43, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. God promises here that I will be with you. He promises to be with us in our sorrows. He promised to be with us in our affliction. Now, he did not say we would not go through the rivers and the fire. We will, but he said he would be with us as we go through it. If you're going through a challenging time right now, God wants you to know, I hear you. I feel the pain of your tears, and I'm with you. You're not alone. What did Hagar learn from her encounter with the angel of God? She made this statement, you are the God who sees me. You are the God who sees me. God didn't change her situation of being a slave, but he changed her perspective. God sees me. And this brief statement has been powerful and life-changing for me personally over the years. And just to share a little bit from my own life, there's a close friend of mine, Lisa Powell, who's in the North region. And a few years ago, Lisa texted me and asked me, what's your favorite scripture? And I told her Genesis 16:13 is one of my favorite scriptures. And a few weeks later, she gave me a cushion as a Christmas gift with a scripture written on it. And the cushion is now sitting in a chair in my room. And that's the chair with the cushion on it, but I pointed to the cushion closer. And it has a scripture in it. She gave this name to the Lord who spoke to her. You are the God who sees me, for she said, I have now seen the one who sees me. And it's been my favorite scripture for years because it's something I fought to hold on to all my Christian life. And part of the reason for that is I had a dysfunctional relationship with my father, who was mostly absent all of my years growing up. But that dysfunctional relationship, the view of my father, spilled over in my view of God. Now, my father died earlier this year on March 30th from COVID-19. And I used the time after his death to go through grief recovery, which helped me to get in touch with unresolved feelings, to acknowledge them, and to let go just years of hurt that was there. A part of the recovery process, as I was going through the grief recovery, was to write a letter to my father. And during one of my sessions, I read the letter that I wrote. And I'm going to share here just part of the letter that I wrote at the time. I wrote it to my father. I said, I forgive you for breaking my heart as a little girl when I deeply desired to have a dad, but you were not there. Your actions left me feeling insignificant to you. I forgive you for all these things so I can be free. I can honestly say I have no unresolved bitterness towards my father. I'm now able to see the good that existed in him. But I had to get to that place. And this past Father's Day was uniquely different for me. Usually on Father's Days, I would have this internal battle, this internal struggle. Do I call my father? Do I not call him? Do I say Happy Father's Day? Do I don't? And usually I would, but it would always be this conflict because there are just all those feelings there. And one of the things, I never called him Dad because he was never Dad to me. He never felt like a dad. But the past Father's Day, there was something freeing in a sense that I could just focus on me and God, me and my Heavenly Father, and it just made a world of difference. It solidified in my heart that even though my earthly father was not all that he should have been, my Heavenly Father has always been there. And I came to terms that I serve the God who sees me, the God who has always seen me, the God who has always been there for me, and the God who has brought me freedom, freedom from hurt and pain, but most of all, the freedom to see God and to know that he sees me and to be able to really see God as my dad. He's a dad I've always had, that I've always wanted, and a dad who's always been there for me. I know it's important for us to have a proper perspective of God, because if we don't have a proper perspective of God, it will lead to a misunderstanding of God that will lead to a misunderstanding of our circumstances. And so we don't want to get messed up in our thinking of God because we'll read into our circumstances incorrectly. Now, telling Hagar to go back and submit to Sarah doesn't make sense from a human perspective. But we'll hit those crossroads in life when doing the right thing doesn't seem to make sense. And the lesson to learn is when life doesn't make sense, we need to cling tightly to God's word. Now, we must make the choice to trust God over our feelings. Now, that's a lot easier said than done. I believe as women, we can feel very strongly and passionately about things. Not because we feel strongly about something, that doesn't mean that it's right. So what does Hagar do? She obeys God and returns to Sarah. Now let's continue to follow Hagar's story. We're going to pick it up in Genesis 21. When Isaac grew up and was about to be weaned, Abram prepared a huge feast to celebrate the occasion. But Sarah saw Ishmael, the son of Abraham, and her Egyptian servant Hagar making fun of her son Isaac. So she turned to Abraham and demanded, "Get rid of that slave woman and her son. He's not one to share the inheritance with my son Isaac. I won't have it." This upset Abraham very much because Ishmael was his son. But God told Abraham, "Do not be upset over the boy and your servant. Do whatever Sarah tells you, for Isaac is a son through whom your descendants will be counted. But I will also make a nation of the descendants of Hagar's son, because he's your son too." So Abram got up early the next morning, prepared food and a container of water, and strapped them on Hagar's shoulder. Then he sent her away with their son, and she wandered aimlessly in the wilderness of Beersheba. When the water was gone, she put the boy in the shade of a bush. Then she went and sat down by herself about 100 yards away. "I don't want to watch a boy die," she said as she burst into tears. But God heard the boy crying, and the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven. "Hagar," one said, "Hagar, what's wrong? Do not be afraid. God has heard the boy crying as he lies there. Go to him and comfort him, for I will make a great nation from his descendants." Then God opened Hagar's eyes, and she saw a well full of water. She quickly filled her water container and gave the boy a drink. And God was with the boy as he grew up in the wilderness. He became a skillful archer, and he settled in the wilderness of Paran. His mother arranged for him to marry a woman from the land of Egypt. Now this account we read here, some 16 years later, after Hagar's first encounter with God. So some 16 years later, Hagar finds herself once again in the wilderness, this time by force rather than by choice. And you know, it tells us that she burst into tears. You know, Hagar quite likely felt pretty hopeless at this point. You know, for 16 years, things had gone well, but now this. And we can have those times. We have the time periods where things go really well, and then something huge happens. And she may have felt abandoned by God, may have felt like, "God, what's happening?" And we can have those times we're like, "God, what's happening? What's going on here?" Verse 17 tells us, "But God heard the boy crying." God not only sees us, he also hears us. He hears us. He sees us and he hears us. But something else I want to point out that's very important. It says, but God heard the boy crying, and the angel of the God and the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven, Hagar, what's wrong? And that's pretty significant. He says, Hagar, what's wrong? Not Hagar, slave of Sarah, which she was called before. You see, she was no longer a slave. She was finally free. She gained a gift of freedom, but it came at a price. God allows us to go through difficult times to give us something better, but better comes at a price. You know, God gives her a promise and tells her, verse 19 tells us, then God opened Hagar's eyes and she saw a well full of water. God opened her eyes and she saw a well full of water. God didn't make a well appear. He opened her eyes to see what was already there. Oftentimes, when we're going through a difficult time, we get blinded by our situation. It's hard to see anything besides our pain. All we can see is the present pain that we're going through, and we need God to open our eyes. When we hit those painful points in life, it's important to allow ourselves to feel and to get real with God, to express our heart to God, to pour out our hearts to God. There's a book I've been reading called It's Not Supposed to Be This Way by Lisa Turkus, and there's a quote in it I want to look at. It says, to deny my feelings any voice is to rob me of being human. But to let my feelings be the only voice will rob my soul of healing perspectives, which God wants to comfort me and carry me forward. And it's finding that right balance to get real with our feelings, so to not deny what you're feeling, to give voice to those feelings, but then allow God to lead you, to express them, but to allow your heart and your mind and your life to be directed by God's word. You know, the disappointments we face in life are oftentimes exactly what we need to encounter God and to have our eyes open. God sees Hagar. He hears her. He enters into her pain and he provides for her. And God didn't just do that for Hagar. I believe Hagar's story is there for us to know that God does the same thing for us. He sees us. He hears us. He enters into our pain and he provides for us. You know, Isaiah, I'll just read this one. Isaiah 43:19 tells us, I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. God tells us that he's making a way. I believe God has given each of us a story. We may be living through a challenging time right now, or we may have lived through one in the past. Whatever story you have, whatever challenges you've been through, you know, ask yourself, how has God transformed my tears and my trials into a testimony? Or how will God transform my present tears and trials into a testimony? You have a story to tell that will give people hope. It will give them hope that God sees, that God hears, and that God cares. And something I want to say right now, and I mentioned earlier, if you came on later, if your sound, if your audio is down, turn it up. I'm going to play a video that I want us to listen to and look at the words as we listen to it and allow it to speak to our hearts. It's called Never Alone. Make sure my audio is up. Okay.
In my time, I've traveled some roads, a rolling stone. Nowhere feels like home. And I've seen people come, then they go. And life is just a story of some highs and some lows. Tell me, do you believe in miracles? I'm standing here before your eyes. I've cried many rivers, I walked through some pain, I've seen my world crumble, and I've carried the shame. But I know somebody, he calls me his own. I can hear heaven sing. Wants to be king. We put all our hope inside material things. In your light, I now understand that everything I have ain't everything that I am. Oh, sometimes I feel like I'm not good enough, but that's when love says you're mine.
Not deeper still.
Yeah,
you've come too far to give up now. Let's go.
How many rivers?
Hopefully enjoy that as much as I did. But just in closing, just a reminder of the God who sees, hears, and cares. He sees each of us, he hears each of us, and he cares for each of us very deeply. Amen.